Hello, welcome to our webinar today. I'm Jonathan Simonis with Enterprise Asset Management Product Support. And we have on the line today Matt Wearley, our mobile specialist, and Jance Carney, one of our mobile developers. Today we're here to talk about the Central Square EAM mobile for Android app, the phase two release of this app that we just have coming out. So we're going to jump into it. So to start out, we want to go over just a kind of a couple reminders about this new application. It is a brand new application, which includes a complete rewrite of the mobile map interface. We're working on getting our mobile apps up to date with Esri's kind of current, the way they do things currently. This is a phased approach. So the first phase included some basic functionality, and the second phase adds additional support for some features and additional tools. We're also rebranding the application. It is now called the Central Square EAM mobile app, and you'll see the Central Square icon in it. If you want to go look for it in the Play Store, the Google Play Store, you will need to look up, you know, CSEAM. And another cool thing about this is that you can try this out alongside the Lucidy 2.0 application. So you can already have your tablets with Lucidy 2.0 on them, and you can install the CSEAM mobile app side by side. It won't use any extra licensing. That way you can work on, you know, setting it up and transitioning people to it as you're ready to implement, you know, Esri's web maps. All right, so let's talk about the requirements for the app. First, your device's OS needs to be at Android 6 or higher. And also, your Enterprise Asset Management or Lucidy version needs to be at 20.1 or higher. So that would be 20.1, 20.2, 20.3, or we just released 21.1. A couple weeks ago. All right. So in phase one, we added the following features, or we started out with the following features. So just a little bit of a reminder. So first of all, we added support for the Esri web maps. That means that you can use maps that were published in ArcGIS Online or published in an ArcGIS portal. We now use the GIS views configured to the web application for the web map. These views are they're easier to use. They support the Esri web maps, and you can configure them right in the web application. So you no longer use the legacy Lucidy map setup in the Lucidy admin tool for configuring your map and the tools and such. We added the table of contents with the legend and the ability to control layer visibility. We added the identify tool, selection, clear selection tool, the current location, and the show a map tool. So that's what we started out with in phase one. So today, in our demo, we're going to go over the new features in phase two. So that starts out with base map swapping, bookmarks, point location tool, searching for addresses, finding assets, seeing relationships, being able to see GIS attributes in the selection pane, and being able to open a form from the identify and selection tools. So jump right into the Lucidy form. And then finally, support for Esri single sign-on. So being able to log into Lucidy using your ArcGIS credentials. All right, so now we're going to jump into the demo.
So this, of course, is a dashboard. And if you tap on the map, you're going to notice, if you've looked at the phase one map, you're going to notice that this map has a whole lot more stuff. a lot more tools along the top here. And so I'm just going to go through these starting from left to right and kind of show you what's here and what we've added and how it works. So this first tool is the table of contents. And in phase one of the table of contents, we had layers. So it shows all of the various layers that are set up, configured in your web map. And you can see here, there are toggles to turn on and off individual layers. So I have some turned off and some turned on. And then the legend shows symbology for all the various features that are currently showing in your map. Those two things were in the phase one release. We have now added to the table of contents this base map tab. And so when you tap on the base map tab, you're going to see thumbnails here of all the base maps that are available to you along with the title. And these base maps are the base maps that are configured that are available in your portal. So this will vary depending on what you have configured for your users to use as far as base maps, but anything that's available in the portal will show here as far as base maps. And it's just as simple as a tap to change the base map to something else. Now, I want to say that, as you may know, the Esri web maps require a base map. So you're going to have a base map automatically that loads with your map. And so that base map that I had when it first loaded is the one that's configured as part of my web map. That will not change. This is not changing the GIS view, the web map that's in the view. This is just changing it while you're using in this particular session. It also does not save it to the session state. So if I back out and come back in, it's going to reload the base map that's part of the web map in the view. But for now, I have lots of options. I have lots of options here. And so I can, you know, change to whatever map, whatever base map that I want for a particular thing. Here's a cool one that shows terrain. It's a little bit hard to see, but if you zoom out, it's kind of cool terrain. And you know, it allows you to, again, use and alternate between base maps depending on what your users are doing. And as I said, if you back out and open the map back up again, it will reload the base map that was there that's part of the configuration in the view. So that's the ability to swap base maps. The next tool over is the home button, which has not changed. That still takes you to the default extent of your map and the default rotation of your map. The next button is bookmarks. And bookmarks are now shared across platforms. So when I tap this bookmark icon, I'm going to get a list of bookmarks that are available to the user. And you can see there are quite a few here. I also have the ability to see just my bookmarks. So these are ones that I have created. But no matter which one you use, using these bookmarks is pretty straightforward. These bookmarks are the same bookmarks that are in the web application. And so if you add one, edit one, delete one here, it'll show up in the web. Or if you add them in the web, they'll show up here. So if you want to use one of these, just tap on this little icon here that looks like a magnifying glass / zoom, and it will take you to that extent of the map. You know, you may need to figure out which exact bookmark you need so you can move around between them. Once you've gotten to the bookmark you need, once you've gotten to the extent you need, you can either hit the cancel button or just tap outside of that dialog and it closes it for you. Some other things here inside the bookmark dialog. We also allow you to create bookmarks here. So here I have a button for creating bookmarks. And let me actually get back out of this. And I'm going to go find some different extent. Let's see. Just go here to this park. So I can tap And if I want to create a bookmark showing this extent, it's just as easy as tapping create. I can type in a name, a bookmark. I can type in a description. And as you'll see, the extent is already populated there for you. So if I tap save, then I have now saved that bookmark and it's now showing in my bookmark list. It also shows in all bookmark lists. And so now I can use that bookmark. If I were to go back to my home extent and use that bookmark, whoops, selected that, tap it there. And we are now back to that extent where we were. So creating a bookmark is pretty straightforward. And like I said, anything you create here then shows up in the web. That also means it shows up in our iOS application as well. So across all of our platforms, those bookmarks are now shared. So if I want to change one of these bookmarks, let's say that I actually wanted this bookmark to show both of these parks. So I can change a bookmark, and again, very straightforward. If you tap on the bookmark icon and you find the bookmark that you want to change and highlight it, you'll now see that I have edit and delete down here. So I can edit this bookmark and I can change the name or the description, but it's also showing me that this is my existing extent, which is the one that's currently saved for this bookmark. And this is the current map extent. So it's going to replace the existing one with the current one. And I can do that by toggling this on and saving. And once I've done that, then a bookmark now represents this extent rather than the one I had saved before. So that allows you to change not only the title and the description, but also the extent of a bookmark if you want to shift it a little bit. And finally, if I tap again on that one and I can now delete it down here again and it'll pop it open so you can see the name and the description and the extent, make sure that it's really the one that you want to delete. And then you hit delete, it's gone from your list. So those are bookmarks. While I'm in here, I'm going to move over to one that I want to kind of be in this area for the next few features. So the next tool is the location tool, and that has not changed. It is the same as it was in phase one. The clear selection is also the same. It's just clearing out whatever you have populated in your selection pane. The selection tool itself hasn't changed, but we've added some things to it, and we've also added some things to identify. So I'm going to start with identify, and we'll come back to selection here in a moment. But if I'm going to go down here and tap on this hydrant and identify that. So the identify pane opens up here on the right, and you'll notice right away that in the first phase, we had create requests, create work orders, and create inspections. But we have now added these two icons. This is the open form button, which you would be familiar with from the Bluesty 2.0 app. This allows you to tap on this and open the record for this hydrant. So if I tap on that, it's going to open the form for the hydrant record in the hydrant module. The other button is the relationships button, and we've replaced this icon with this one we use in the web application, so they're the same. But this will show me records that are associated to this hydrant. So if I tap on this relationship button, I get a list here. It's showing I have 7 inspections on this hydrant, 1 work order, 1 flow test. Those are the two new buttons in identify. So now we're going to go back to selection. And I'm going to actually select a few things here. So you'll notice when I select a few things here that I get them over here in the selection pane. The same buttons are here that were in phase one, create request and create work order. But if I actually drill into one of these, now I have 2 hydrants here, and now the relationship button shows up here. So what this will do is it'll actually give me the relationships to both of these hydrants. So if I tap on this, you're going to notice that I have 15 inspections, 2 flow tests, 2 work orders. I can also, from this pane, I can select one of these, I can choose one of these, and I can then open the relationships button again. And now it's giving me the relationships to just step one. So now I'm only getting 7 inspections, 1 flow test, 1 work order. So again, ability to get to relationships in different ways, to a single record or to all the ones that you're seeing here in the pane. Once you have chosen a record or highlighted a record, selected it, the form button opens, shows up here as well. So this allows you to, again, open the record for that particular hydrant. The other thing then that you'll notice that's different here in the selection pane is we now have this orange eye here, which allows you to get to the attributes. So for this water hydrant, I can now tap on this and it'll open up the attributes. These are the GIS attributes for this particular hydrant. And you can scroll through these here. And also at this level, you'll notice that you still have the open form and the relationships. So these will work just like if you had it selected in the previous pane, but once you are down to this level, you can do it here as well. So those are the 3 things that we've added to identify and selection: the ability to open the form, the ability to get to the related records, and the ability to view GIS attributes. And I'll clear out all my junk here. And the next tool over then is a new tool. This is the point location tool. So the point location tool, as you will know from the Lucidy 2.0 app, allows you to plot a point in the map. There are some new pieces to this one specifically. When I open this up, I'm now in the point location tool, but I have the selection pane open here. So if I had already selected some assets like hydrant or a pipe or whatever, they would still show here and I could add a point to this list and then do something with all of that data together. But in this case, we'll just show a point. So you can just add a point by tapping somewhere on the map. I'm going to tap right about here. And you'll see that it plots my point there, and it then adds that location in the selection pane on the right. What this does is it's collecting the coordinates and then it's reverse geocoding to give you the address. This also gives you a way to get to the attributes. And so on a location, what you're going to see in the attributes is the address, if there is a valid address connected to that point. And it'll show you the various pieces of the address, like the building number and the city. And these are kind of in a weird order here, but state and zip code is at the bottom. But it also gives you the Latin long, and then it'll give you the coordinates. So all of that information is now available here. The other new thing with this particular map interface is that you can plot multiple points. So I can add more points here if I want. Just kind of tapping around in various places, and you can now see I've got 4 points, and now I can work with all of those at once rather than having to do them individually. So once I have whatever points I want here in the selection pane, create work order and create request work very much like they do everywhere else in the app. So if I create requests, I would be creating an individual request on each of these locations. If I create a work order, I'm going to get this dialogue saying, do you want a single work order or do you want separate work orders? So I'm going to do a single one. And then it gives me the template list if I want to use a template. And if I skip that, it now gives me the category prompt. This is something different from the old app, where the old app we used at the default category in the settings to create these work orders, but now you get the category prompt. So you can choose the category for your point location work orders. And then it'll create the work order and include all of these on it. Now, we still offer that default category setting. So if you have, I'm going to go clear back out to the dashboard here. If you have users who do point location work orders, like maybe graffiti or something. And they're always doing the same category for their work order. If you go up here to the settings, I mean to the menu in the upper right, and you go to settings, we still have this default category setting. And if this is populated, that's interesting. If this is populated, then it shouldn't prompt you for that category. We'll have to check that out before we release. There is a way to clear this. So if this default category is empty, then it should prompt you for the category. If this default category is populated, then when you create that work order, it should use this default category to create the work order rather than prompting for the category. So again, if you have users that have the same, that are using the same category for their work orders, you can put that here and then they just will skip a prompt as they're going through that workflow. Actually, I'm gonna try something real quick while we're here. Yep, okay. So that is the point location tool. The last thing that I need to say about the point location tool is, you know, the question may be, if I select a point, and so now I have a set of coordinates and an address, when I create this work order, what information out of that is going to be populated into the work order location record? Will it put in the address? Will it put in the coordinates? Will it put in both? And we now follow the system setting that's in the web application, which is how the web map does as well. So if I go over here to our web application, and if I go to the admin portal to system settings, in the GIS section of our system settings, there is this setting. And that setting determines what goes into that location record when you create it from a point. So I currently have this set to both so that it would populate both the address and the XY into that location record. But I can change it so that it just populates the coordinates or it just populates the address. So the mobile applications, both Android and iOS both, will now follow this setting when it creates that location record on your work order. All right. The next tool is, again, one you're familiar with, and this is search for address. So the magnifying glass is a search for address. If I tap on this, I get a small dialog here to be able to enter an address. And you'll notice as I type in, I'm getting suggestions. So this is new. So we now have a suggestion list, which the web app does as well. And these suggestions are coming from the default extent of your map. So we're not going to show you addresses in Oregon if you are in Florida, unless your map extent is set that way. So it does filter them down so that they're local addresses. And once you tap on one of these, whoops, I did Riley. Let's go back and do that again. There we go. You can actually, that's a good point. You can actually do two and they'll stay in your selection pane because this is populating your selection pane. We've got an issue with the zoom on this. So we have a little bit of a bug to fix because it's not zooming correctly. So you can see both of these points. There's the other point. But they're both here. And so now you're in the selection pane and you can do everything here that you would with any point location. So again, choosing to create work orders or requests would work the same way. So that is the address search. And finally, we have the find asset tool, which is the binoculars. This works very much like the one in the old map did. When you tap on it, you get this dialog. You can search on all asset types for a particular value, or this is actually a drop down. So you can choose what kind of asset to search on. So I'm going to go down here and search on water hydrants. And then you type in what value you want. So I'm going to type in this because I know that that's a water hydrant in our system. So pull it up for us. And then I can tap on the find and it'll zoom out, tell me that it found one, and it will plot that asset. And again, I've opened in a selection mode. So then I can do all the things I would normally do in selection mode. If I don't know the exact value, then this has the ability to do a partial search. So the characters for that are shown here. A percent represents zero to many, or an underscore represents a single character. So in this case, I'm saying I want to see everything that starts with 0000. And then I toggle on the partial search. And when I do my find, now it's finding 9 assets. And you can see in my list here that all of them start with that 0000. And they have all plotted here. Once you've done that, then again, this works just like the selection pane. So everything, all the tools are the same. You're basically in selection mode. So you can use these tools just like you can in selection or in the point location. So that covers all the tools that we've added. We've added a lot. Hopefully that gives you all a lot more of the stuff you'll need so that you can begin the process of kind of moving into using this new interface. The last thing I want to show really quickly is that we did add support for Esri single sign-on. And I want to remind you again that that does require 20.3 or 21.1. So if you want to use it, you'll need to upgrade to one of those. And there's also a little bit of configuration that's required to get that to work for the mobile applications, but we'll have that documented so you can refer to that, or support can help you get that set up. But I'm going to go log out. And I'm actually connected to a 21.1 environment. So this is my client list on the app. And when I hit connect, you're going to see that I have the ArcGIS login button here right underneath the SAML button. So this will appear if you have this configured to be able to be used in your applications. If not, then the button will not show there, but it will show. So once you tap that, it's just like the web application. It prompts you with your Esri credentials. I'm going to type this in. I'm going to minimize this briefly while I type my password so that you guys can't see my password. And then when you hit sign in, it skips our prompt, it logs you into our app. And then when you open the map, you aren't prompted for credentials. So it works just exactly like the web app does. It's just saving you a set of credentials. Again, I can open my map and it'll open up my map for me, take me back to where I was before. So that's the single sign-on. So those are the features that we are releasing. Again, hopefully those will be out either later today or tomorrow. And before I open it up for questions, I'm just gonna go back to this and just let you know what's coming. So this was phase 2. We have already started working on phase 3, and our plan for that, with this disclaimer, which we always do, we're working on these things, but things oftentimes shift. And so we can't guarantee that these are coming, but this is what our plan is. And that is that we are working on feature editing and redlining, which are two very similar kinds of features. We are also working on add to existing, which is the ability to add an asset to an existing work order. So that would be, you do a show and map. So now you have a work order plotted in the map, and then you can add assets or locations to that work order. We're also working on driving directions. That's the kind of tentative plan for this next release. Although depending on how we move through those over the next few weeks, we may also go ahead and add the advanced show and map in this release. If we don't, we may go ahead and release those first four things and do the advanced joint map in a separate smaller release. But we'll just kind of have to see how we do as we get closer to that time. And then our final release will of course be this ability to support offline maps. So that is what I had planned to share with you all today. Jonathan, I'll send it back to you and see if there are any questions.
All right, we have a couple, and Jensen's already answered one in the chat, so I'll go on and start with that one. Do the bookmarks apply just to the particular web map that is opened? And Jensen said, no, the bookmarks are available to a user, that are available to a user can be opened across different web maps.
And great.
Sound like the response was they were kind of looking for an enhancement request there. I think that would have to be an enhancement request for our entire GIS system, because we've basically made it so bookmarks are the same
right
across all platforms, right? Yeah.
Right. Yeah.
I think they had a solid use case there, but yeah, that would have to be an enhancement request to our entire system. Let's see what the other questions that were in the chat. Are you able to upload, download, and view documents from the mobile device?
Upload, download, view documents from the mobile device. Yes, we've always supported you. I mean, if you're talking about images and videos, yes, and PDFs as well. So all of that has not changed. Those are still the same from the Lucy 2.0 app, but we support that in the 3.0 app as well.
All right. And then another question along this, on that same area is, what are the requirements we need to have on the GIS side to be able to make this possible to use the new application on both iOS and Android devices? Go on.
So these, so both Android and iOS for the CSEAM applications, they are using, they are supporting Esri web maps. So if you don't have Esri web maps configured, if you're still using the Lucy legacy maps, then you'll need to begin to work on changing over your configuration to web maps. And then these are also using the GIS views that are configured in the web application for the web maps. So I'm sure, Jonathan, you can correct me, but I'm sure there's some documentation out there in our help guides about how to do all of that. If not, reach out and we can try to get you some information about how to get all of that configured. If you, like I said, if you're using the old Lucy legacy maps, they're not going to work here. So you've got to get shifted over to web maps, to the Esri web maps and the GIS views. I hope that answered the question.
Partly, but I think I have the rest of that. So
yeah, great.
The web maps are, when he's saying web maps, he's talking about either AGOL or portal, and using those to generate the maps, and then you create the GIS views. And there's some documentation in the help guide about creating the views and hooking up to portal and all those things. If you're looking for specifics about versions of what versions of ArcGIS this stuff works with, if you go into the support portal and look up EAM version support details, there is an article that's called EAM ArcGIS version support details. And it has a couple PDFs attached to it. One of those shows the versions of Lucidy or Enterprise Asset Management, and it shows the versions of GIS, and it shows which versions are compatible. That's going to be the best way for you to know, which version of, basically they compare which version of ArcGIS you're on, which version of Lucidy you're currently running, and then see if they're compatible. And we do keep that up to date every version, every time the release comes out for our software, and we keep it up to date with releases for Esri for ArcGIS. So I think that answers the rest of that question. And so the follow-up question of that is, when will the old maps, the legacy maps, be supported in the new application, or will they?
At this point, we do not have plans to do that. We wrote this app because we're moving toward the latest Esri technology, if you will. So we have not, I've not planned to support the legacy maps in the new application. If that's something that is critical to you, you might put in a note so that we know that. I'm not guaranteeing that we could do that, but it will be just helpful to know the clients are asking for that.
I think this point's been made in the past, and I know this was true for iOS. Is this true for Android? You can run the Lucidy 2.0 app and the new app simultaneously on the same device.
That's right. Yep, that's right.
So if you have users that are still using the legacy Lucidy maps, they can still be using the Lucidy 2.0 app. And you could also have even on the same device, you could be using the new app. There's no kind of restriction that says you have to just use one of those apps.
Right. And it doesn't take an additional license to do that. So you can do them both at the same time.
Right. Excellent. Okay. Are there any plans to update the 2.0 application and to add layers? I'm not quite sure what that last piece means about adding layers. But are there any plans to update the 2.0 application?
There are not. We are focusing all of our energy on the 3.0 application as we move forward. And so we don't have any plans. In fact, the Android application, we really can't update. We've got a problem, if you will, with Google. They have the Esri SDK that we are using in the 2.0 application is a 32-bit code, and Google will no longer let us update apps with 32-bit code. So we really can't do any enhancements to the 2.0 app.
Gotcha. Okay. All right. Well, checking in the chat and in the QA, and I don't see any more questions. I think it looks like you've answered all the ones that have come up. So
great.
Well, anything you want to close with?
No, I was just going to say, if you think of anything that comes up as you begin to play with it, or as you look at it once it's released today or tomorrow, feel free to post in the support groups, in the support site, or reach out to support and they can help, or they can get me and I can help you. So just let us know what we can do to help you figure it out if you're having trouble with it. Thanks so much for joining us today.
All right. Thanks, Matt. And thanks, everybody.
Yep.